All right, back at her again. Gonna start picking away in no particular order of the remaining items on my to-do list. But just for a treat, and because I can't resist, we'll do a little morning start and let the truck warm up a little. This is just too much fun for me. I mean, it's being able to start it. Man, this is crazy. So yeah, I'm gonna get going on the floor. Finish closing this out, bolt it all in. I'm gonna fiberglass close the holes that I don't need. I'm gonna put bolts from underneath, so it'll be like studs for the seats to bolt in. And then I might get started on putting this flooring in. We'll see how far I get today. But I think first and foremost, as I was playing around, I noticed that this guy is getting stuck. So I'm gonna have to try and get the rods a little more unkinked. So when I was at Greenline, which is a local hose supplier, I noticed they had these brackets to kind of grab the hoses, and I'm thinking that might work for my shifter rods. So if I go underneath, I'll show you what I mean. And it was getting stuck, not in second to third, but third to fourth. So when you put it into fourth gear, it would seem to get hung up. So I don't know if they're getting if it's in the tranny or if it's just the linkage. So I'm gonna try and pull up this guy to keep the rods separated, and ideally I'd get this junk out of here and maybe weld this in, because when it's a proper setup, these rods are running through fixed holes, and I think that keeps them straight. So I'll play with that and see if I can get it fixed, because I don't want it always get stuck in the gear. That's gonna be a royal pain to drive it.
Alright, get
in. Found another leak. So it looks like I'm going to have to replace a lot of this original stuff. This one I might be able to fix. It's just on the air valve, because I'll wire it up. So you can hear it kind of still leaking out of there, I believe. So I'll take this valve off, and maybe I can put some thread sealant on these elbows and see if I can seal it up. But I am thinking a lot of this old stuff needs to be modernized with some newer hoses, newer connections, and just working the bugs out. I'm sure there's going to be a lot more little things that pop up before this truck becomes roadworthy. Just keep picking away at them. So I redid this, put new sealant in there, and it wasn't the one that was leaking. So then I thought the air was leaking out of my new wiper control valve, so I took that off. It's not leaking there. So I'm pulling around, and look at that. It's I don't know if you can see it there. Little pinhole. And then I'm listening, and I think I can hear another leak behind the dash. So it's apparent that all these old lines have got to go. So add that to the to-do list. I'm just gonna have to replace everything. So I don't know, maybe get 50 feet of this line and 30 or so connectors and just start replacing them one by one. Nah, bummer. The tack's been intermittent. It's actually a mechanical drive, an old speedo cable. So it looks like it's turning down. It comes off right off the injector pump. So it looks like it's turning, so maybe it hasn't been reaching far enough into there, or maybe it was just sticking, or this gauge is going. I'll put maybe some silicone in there and see if I can loosen up, get my tack a little more consistent. But as you can see, that's just not really a rat's nest, but a ton of hoses that are going to need to be replaced. Yeah, you can hear another one hissing. So I think the best thing to do is just to clean all this mess out of here. And like I say, replace the lines one by one, and it's going to be done right. So I think what's happening is the second rod, the third and fourth gear, I think is extending too far, and it goes past center in the transmission, which is why it gets hung up. So now what I'm trying to do is loosen this nut off and adjust this to where I think she's just in gear, and then I'm going to tighten the rod up. So I'm going to extend this out
maybe 5 or 10 threads, and then we'll see if that, maybe about 5 threads, and see if that kind of takes up the slack in the rod, and then it won't allow me to overshift it and get it stuck. Buy a twin sticks truck, they say. It'll be fun, they say. So I figured out why it was hanging up. The good news is it wasn't in the transmission. It actually had to do with these rods. So what was happening was the lock nut here was catching. There's an aluminum cross member, and what was happening is the rod would drop down and it would catch on this little lip. So I tried to monkey around with it and grind it smooth, but it was still catching. So I had to pull the rods out. So now what I'm going to do is, I noticed there's lots of thread here, so I think I'm going to take this and extend it all the way to the end, and that way it'll just be riding on the rod. If that doesn't work, I'll have to weld this all up, make it all smooth, which might be the best way to go, and then grind it all smooth, and that way it doesn't have a little edge to catch on, because it's just amazing that right where you shift the gear is right where this lands. It drops down and then gets caught. Oh, I love old trucks. All right, shifting gears away from the, no pun intended, from the shift rods. So what I'm gonna have to do there is weld build up and then grind it smooth, because it's still catching even when I made the adjustment. So I'm gonna park that for now. Now I'm onto the seats. So just verifying which holes are the ones that line up. So it appears it actually lines up pretty darn good. So I'm just gonna put bolts in from the bottom, because I only have access when this floor is gone. So they'll almost be, like I said earlier in the video, just like studs that I can set the seat on, and then I put the flooring in and I can cut around those so I can set it down and bolt the seats down. Boy, those are gonna look pretty sweet. This would be the most important test, to make sure that it's actually gonna shift without hitting. So it's gonna be awfully close to my passenger's knee, but that's how she goes with twin sticks. But it looks like it's gonna clear the seat when I put the seat all the way back, so that's awesome. Yeah, that's gonna be real nice. So, you know, these cabs, these 359s are awfully small. So the seat's all the way back, and we've just got enough clearance on that second shifter. So it looks like it's gonna work. Only thing is, I guessed a little too short on the bolts, so they're not gonna be long enough to put my nylon lock nuts on there. So back to the bolt house to get an inch longer, but at least I can put them in there and I can flip the seat out. Or maybe I'll flip the other one in here and just make sure these are the four holes that they line up. And that way I can fill all the other holes. And yeah, we'll have our two seats in. Well, eventually the studs will be there, and then I still got to put it in the floor. So much to do, so much to do. That one lined up perfectly. And of course, this one doesn't. Look, the one stud there, I don't know if I can get the camera, is just a little off. I can't believe it. How could that be? Who would have drilled that hole? Look at that. You can see it in there that it's not gonna line up. So I guess I'm gonna have to, I don't know, I just drill out the plate. Ah, what a pain. Nothing's easy. Wow, now the cab's full of seats. I mean, they're really nice. There's still room for me to sit and reach the pedals, which is cool, but it's cozy. It sure would be nice to have that big cutout and tilt the seats all the way back. I'm gonna have to have a real skinny person to fit through there to get into the sleeper. But yeah, this is real nice. So at least I know they both fit in there, and I can still get behind the steering wheel, so that's cool. And the shifters hit all the gears, so right on. So I'm still missing seat belts. There actually wasn't any seat belts in this truck when I bought it, so someone somewhere along the way must have chucked them out. And I need the old lap belts, the old school lap belts. So they basically have a hook from here, and they connect the bolt in here, and then from there you've got a lap belt that goes up and over. But so new from Peterbilt, I think they're about $300 a piece. So if anyone out there knows where I could find or has a couple old lap belts from an old truck that are in decent shape, hit me up. Send me an email, 359twinsticks@gmail.com, because I could really use them. I need them to get my safety certification. So last time I was at Stall Peterbilt, I noticed the new 389s had these really sharp looking white and red mud flaps, so I had to get me a pair of those. I figure that looks pretty sharp. Knocking the ugly off. Okay, so that was the fun part. Now I gotta get back to grinding on this cab. As I mentioned, I got the seats out now, and now I gotta fill in all these holes that were used for who knows what. The best thing to do would probably be to weld them closed, but I'm just gonna use fiberglass filler. And I know people are probably gonna give me hell for that, but I'm not the most skilled welder, and this is just going underneath the floor. So I think that'll work okay. And then I also need to, someone suggested, which I think is a great suggestion, is to stain this or treat this wood, because of course water's gonna be splashing up underneath. So I'm gonna have to run to Lowe's or Home Depot and get something to coat that. And then I also realized I can't put my new floor in until I finish welding those shifter rods and cleaning those up so they don't stick, because the only access I can get is through here. And of course I would put the floor over top. I won't have access anymore. So I'll fill these holes, and then I'm gonna continue with the, I guess you call it the tin foil and the foam around the cab. Figure it's a good day to do that. Someone made a comment a while back. They called me the Bob Ross of truck repair, which I thought was pretty cool. I don't know if I'm as calm and cool as Bob Ross, but my daughter and I actually did get into, well, both my daughters, into trying to do some Bob Ross paintings this winter, and use it's called a painting knife. So as you can see, I never really did get the hang of it, but I'm doing my best, and nobody's ever gonna see this painting underneath the truck, but I think this is gonna do good. Keep out the rain and the small critters. So you get the idea. I'm sure people that do proper restorations are probably yelling at their screens right now, but you know, my dad taught me to do the best you can with what you got. So this is what we're doing here with this this whole project. I think it'll work just fine. So I'll keep trying to get this as smooth as I can, and then I'll finish prepping the floor to get ready for that for the flooring install. Finnegan and Freiberger would be proud. Good old zip ties. They work good in this case, I think. It'll hold all the lines together. I'm just trying to connect everything in nice groupings so nothing rubs, like the clutch lever arm there, and just trying to organize this up and hopefully never have to take this floor out again. I guess time will tell. So you gotta wonder what the engineers were thinking when they put a grease circ there, because how are you ever gonna get that from the bottom? There's no way. And then there's another one underneath here. I mean, there's just no room between the frame. There's about an inch of space there. So nothing against engineers, I am one, but boy, I guess those only get greased once at the factory, and then again 40 years later when you take the floor out. Too funny. So as I was down here digging around, I found a couple wires that don't go anywhere. They're not hooked up. And the cool thing with these old Petes is they're actually, every wire should be numbered. So 242, and this guy is 269. So then you go to your trusty wiring diagrams in your manual. And of course I got greasy fingers, so wreck all these pages. But so it looks like 242 and 269 go through a backup lamp switch to turn on your white backup lights. So then I'm trying to think, well, where would that switch be? So you can't put the secondary transmission into reverse, only the front one. So I'm thinking that these guys came off of this little sensor here. So I'm wondering how I can test for that. I wonder if I put this in reverse, if I get some kind of connection there, continuity.
So I'll play around with that, and if so, then I'll either see if I can connect these to this old guy or maybe get a new one. But I'm thinking that's what happened. They just got ripped off, or someone took them off at one point in time. So that's pretty neat. You can troubleshoot. All right, so I think mystery solved. So if I go to ohms, so when continuity, when they connected, they're at zero. So if I put them in the little, wasp, get out of here. See you later. No wasp nest in my truck. Put these guys in this sensor, and then all the way over and up is reverse. It pretty much goes to zero. So that shows you that that is the reverse sensor. And then when I check these guys out and check them for power, see DC volts. So of course we got zero without the key off. And then if I turn the key on, now it's interesting, we don't get 12, we only get 6, but it does show that there's power going to it. So mystery solved. The thing is though, that this was a hot wire just sitting down there. And of course, if it touches anything metal, it's going to ground out, which is recipe for fire. So it shows there's still lots of work that needs doing on the wiring to make sure this thing's not going to burn to the ground. I think I'm going to need a bigger piece of gyprock for my list of things to do. As I start on one project, I get distracted and go to 6 others. But I guess any progress is progress. So as I was saying, getting distracted on other jobs. So I was down here doing some zip tying, and I noticed that exhaust clamp was garbage, so I'll have to replace that. And I thought, while I'm down here, I might as well drain the oil out of the front tranny and check out the spot for the drain plug right over top of the exhaust pipe. I mean, isn't that brilliant? So I mean, I'll clean it up as best I can, but there's gonna be oil all over the pipe, so she's gonna smoke when I start it up. I don't know why they didn't put a drain right at the center of the back. Oh well. And then there's my loyal dog Biff supervising. So there you go, chocolate pudding over an exhaust pipe. Lovely. Hope my pan holds what the amount is in there. So yeah, we'll put some new 50 weight in there. Plug looked perfect though, although this doesn't look like a magnet plug, so maybe that's why. So I'll probably the fill plug, I believe, is a magnet on this side, so I'll pull that big plug there and see if there's any metal. Not expecting any. Fingers crossed.